afternoon. Today I'll go over the mandate in the United States to increase public access to federally funded research results. I'll show some examples of different federal agency plans, and then I'll go over the collaborations that are helping Smithsonian to implement its own public access plan. On February 22, 2013, the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy, or OSTP, issued a memo that requires federal agencies to create plans to increase public access to publications and data resulting from the research that they fund. Generally speaking, the public is supposed to have access after publication plus an embargo period. The OSTP memo requires that all agencies apply to peer-reviewed scientific publications and digital data, use the accepted manuscript as the earliest version for compliance, uses a 12-month embargo. The memo actually sets a 12-month embargo as the guideline, but most agencies are using it as their required embargo. Plans must ensure long-term stewardship of the materials and leverage existing agency resources, which means none of the agencies receive new money from the government for this initiative. 18 months after the OSTP memo, the first agency plan was issued by the Department of Energy. And last month, just short of the four-year anniversary of the memo, OSTP announced that all agency plans had finally been approved. There are more than 20 agency plans, and you can see from these examples that there are some differences. Effective dates can be based on submission, acceptance, publication, or grant award, and can be different depending on researcher type. In most cases, the agencies use their own repositories, and some plans, including the Smithsonian's, explicitly include papers in edited volumes. It's important to mention here that Smithsonian is not a federal agency. It is designated as a trust instrumentality of the United States government, and it operates with both federal and private funds, though the majority are federal. The institution has many employees who are not paid with federal money, so products of their work are copyrightable, as opposed to automatically in the public domain for most federal or all federal employees. And Smithsonian is not a grant-making agency, so it's not always understood that it should be identified as a funder. In creating its public access plan, Smithsonian had four key issues to solve. Public access being unfunded, our research budget is not comparable to large grant-making agencies like NSF and NASA, so making use of our existing staff and systems was critical. We needed to ensure proper execution of publishing agreements because neither our employees nor their co-authors are authorized to sign agreements on behalf of the institution. We had to figure out how to start measuring compliance, not only at article level, but as an institution. And we had to ensure long-term preservation and access. Smithsonian has two key major collaborations that are helping with implementation of its public access plan. Both fulfill all of our four key issues. The internal collaboration between Smithsonian's scholarly press, which I'm the director of, and our libraries combines knowledge of scholarly publishing and contracts with an existing repository called Smithsonian Research Online, or SRO, and a ticketing system that tracks contracts. SRO harvests metadata as it becomes available online and serves as our primary repository for accepted manuscripts. Smithsonian's relationship with CORUS is under its agency agreement, and so is at no direct cost, and helps facilitate contract negotiation with CORUS publisher members, which publish up to 50% of Smithsonian scholarly output every year. It also provides a suite of data aggregation services to help measure compliance, and CORUS's relationships with Portico and Clox ensure long-term preservation if all else fails. One unexpected but welcome collaboration has been with publishers directly. We're working with some publishers to create blanket contract addenda for all Smithsonian-authored articles. The riders expedite per turnaround of publishing agreements, ensure standard public access terms for our publications, and minimize or eliminate additional work for the publishers. And a quick look to other challenges. The new U.S. administration to date has not given the agencies any guidance about where public access is on its list of priorities. A new interagency working group on open science has been formed and is chartered through July to provide recommendations to the National Science and Technology Council, so I hope to know more either before or by summer. Longstanding publisher practice is actually posing quite a few challenges for us. For Smithsonian, authorized signature is bypassed when an author signs his or her own contracts and when authors must complete click-through agreements online. Also, checking the acknowledgments seems to no longer be sufficient to identify funders. Affiliations are now indicators of funding. Smithsonian is asking staff and fellows to list the institution in their acknowledgments, but we aren't yet sure if this is catching on. And one issue, the IWGOS, which is the Interagency Working Group, hopes to work on is multi-agency funding, where researchers have funding from more than one agency. Right now, the scholars have to comply with multiple plans because there's no reciprocity plan. And data that's just kind of out there.